spirits of the house are up the dark and stair. He led me to a passage unfamiliar.
Sheep steam and blood and a man in a bed
with no clue to why he bled. Edward, am I still alive? I did not think that I'd survive her rage.
It's Mr. Mason.
Oh, it's Jim, a bandage. Oh, it's just a sprain, my friend. A wound better will help us mend. Must we keep her locked inside a cage? Just do not speak, no words.
There's teeth marks here.
Yes, yes, it's true. She said she drained my heart. Just be silent. Gather your strength. We must leave him now.
He's not fit to be moved, sir.
You must coach the man.
Yes, sir.
She's lost to me, I fear.
Courage, man.
I thought I'd do some good. It's my heart I blame. I should have stayed away, but like a fool, I came. Sirens call the sailors. She called my name. Let her be treated gently and kindly.
It shall be done, my friend, as it has always been done. Now, Jane, I will return it to your chamber.
No need.
As every need. Wish to talk with you. Were you afraid?
I was curious.
Curious? Not the stranger who bleeds, but the dead that catches fire, but the house that holds down mystery. But most, Jane, curious about the man who lives in this dark place.
Yes.
The man whom hope has quitted, and for whom the sun and moon has long been darkened into eclipse. To return and bear his memories. He has wandered the world seeking rest in exile and happiness in heartless sensual pleasure. And now he lives on the crust of a crater, which any day will crack beneath his feet and swallow him into a fire. Who do you think would make the perfect wife for this wretched man? Miss Ingram, do you suppose? A woman whose moral stature is equal to his own? No, you don't agree. Not Blanche Ingram make my perfect wife.
You cannot ask me such a question.
Please, Jane, advise me. Tell me what to do, my only friend.
It is not for me to say, sir. If you are troubled in your thoughts, a fellow creature cannot help you. Men and women die. Philosophers falter in wisdom, Christians in goodness. If certainty is what you seek, you must look to a higher power for strength to amend and solace to heal.
Jane, I am suffering. I know who gives me strength. I know who heals my life. Well, Jane, when will you sit up with me again?
Whenever I can be useful, sir.
Well, you can be useful the night before I'm wed. Sure, I won't sleep. Will you sit up with me then and bear me company? To you I can talk of my lovely one, for now you have seen her and know her.
No, sir.
No.
If you are to marry, then I must leave this place.
Really? Why? Well, it must be your decision, of course. I would be lonely here without you, my little elf. Good night, my Jane.
What a fool I have been to wonder if he might have a care for me. How insane the thought that you could be to him dear in any way. Oh, what an absurd young girl has lived. loveliest face, the most delicate skin, a tribute to beauty, the perfect skin. Her it's neither diamond ring nor golden bars. Make her a lady of rank, listening Satan, oh, how she glows. Mixed in your finest tints, paint her dramatically, with all your sweetest tunes, sit here
Really? Come along, Mama.
Oh, do let's go.
those ladies that are young and single.
Well, really?
Really, Robert?
Come on, Claire.
I'll go first.
Forgive me, Miss Eyre, but the gypsy says she must see all the single young ladies, whatever their stations.
Oh, I would go by all means, Robert. Perhaps I may learn something of my future. Yes, sir.
It is a shame. Compton is such a pleasant place in the summer. some way attached to his house.
I have grown quite attached to Thornfield.
And to that foolish little child, Adele. Even a simple little fat.
In different ways, I have affection for them both. I shall be sorry to leave here.
Must you really leave, Jack?
Mr. Rochester, you are to be married, are you not?
Yes, what?
Adele ought to go to school. I'm sure you perceive the necessity of it.
To keep her out of my bride's way, and otherwise walk over her too emphatically. There is sense in the suggestion.
I shall advertise for a new situation.
Oh, nonsense, Jamie, that's it.
You need not take the trouble.
It's no trouble. I have, in fact, already held a suitable position. The Honorable Lady Ingram. Jane. You are to undertake the education of the five daughters of Mrs. Dionysus O'Gore at Bitternut Lodge in Kilkenny. I am
armed. I really must object.
This is Miss.
I don't agree, sir.
When you're gone, I shall think of you out on the glen. You seem so like a fairy.
Such a distance, why so far, sir?
Where does that disturb you?
It's a long way.
But from what, Jane? Why does that disturb you, Jane? We've been friends.
It's getting late, sir.
Jane, what is wrong?
I must come in, sir.
Jane, is that a tear that's in your eye?
Yes, it is, and I cry because the pain, because the grief is slowly turning into rage. I'm like a bird upon the brink, who wishes she were never.
With me to live in this house. Shall I bliss with your apricot slip? Are you an eagle coming to the nest? Or a swift or no wind, with no need to rest? Chubby, slender creature.
Impudent, brazen.
So this is the dress? Do you like it? Like it?
I remember long ago when I wore such a dress. He died, poor man, and broke my heart. Still broken. I confess.
I'm very sorry to hear that, Mrs. Fairfax.
A slip of the girl in Chicago, you're ill-equipped to the hills. I'm a slip of the girl, and I bet I'm naturally more than I'm prepared. He's quite a bit older aesthetics. We'll let him be more than a friend. Should we better forget?
No, indeed, Mrs. Fairfax.
Edward Fairfax Rochester, wilt thou have this woman to be thy wedded wife? Wilt thou love her, comfort her?
This marriage cannot go on. I declare the existence of an impediment to your soul.
No, I cannot proceed without further investigation.
I can prove my allegations.
Well, now, what is the nature of the impediment?
Mr. Rochester is already married. He has a wife now living at Thornfield Hall. I saw her there this summer. I am a brother.
Wait, at Thornfield Hall? Well, that's impossible. I am an old resident of this neighborhood, sir. I've never heard of a Mrs. Rochester at Thornfield Hall.
No, my Connor. I took care that no one should ever hear of her. They can close your book, there shall be no wedding today. What this man says is true. The woman is alive. Vicar, Mason, Mrs. Fairfax, I invite you all to the house to meet Grace Poole's patient, my lovely wife.
Your sweet prince of the house, is right before your eyes. You say and feel.
When were you married, sir?
I was a wild boy. Mother saw father who was greedy, avaricious, and self-serving. My father resolved one day he would not divide his property and willed it to my elder brother. Yet my father would not let his wild boy be poor and tarnish his name. He sought me a wife to lessen his shame. So soon I was sent abroad, and a marriage made for money was arranged by both the families. She was a tour of beauty. I was dazzled, I was stimulated, senses were excited. I thought it was.